Trinity Baptist Church family, how are you today? Good morning, Trinity Baptist Church family. How are you? Now here we go. That's good. Why don't we stand this morning and we'll sing, Come. Now is the time to work.
So excited about being here to worship God today. How many of you guys are excited to be in church this morning? I'm so glad to be here. Glad that there's even some clappers. That's awesome. And we're all excited to be here, and we're glad that you're here today. I've been slowly meeting even some folks that haven't been in months and maybe even since last year. So we're glad you're here, and God's going to do some amazing things in our services today. I really believe that. I want to let you know about a couple things that are going on. First of all, we announced this last Sunday night, and we also announced it on Wednesday night. We actually made our goal for our Easter offering. Isn't that awesome? Now watch this. Ready? This is going to blow your mind. Here comes the lights. They're all coming on, unlike our lights sometimes. And then confetti. Confetti? Yeah! Modern technology, I tell you what, it's pretty cool. But we're so excited about that. God's done some great things, and so we're really, really glad. We were able to raise $15,564 for that, and so we're really, really excited about that. If you don't have your teens signed up yet for Camp Choff or for Camp Chautauqua this summer, you need to do that, okay? If you need more information on that, it's in your Trinity update. Hopefully you all got that as you came in today. And make sure that you go sign up your kids for camp. It's one of the most important weeks of the year in the spiritual life of a student. So we would love for them to know about that. We also want to let you know about the Joint Heirs class. This our Adult Bible Fellowship class is having an outreach and celebration. Miss Jeannie Plager is making a bunch of food. Somebody said amen, right? Who here has ever eaten her food? Who here loves her food? Like, that's everybody, right? And so, big meal. It's going to be awesome. They're going to have music, a concert for a bunch of everybody. You can sign up with Brother Gentry or Miss Jeannie, probably. So if you are interested in being a part of that, we'd love to have you there. It's this Friday, isn't it? This Friday at what time? Doors open at 5, start eating at 5:30. So we'd love to have you for that. We're excited about what God's going to do in the rest of our service today. Let's go to Him in prayer, all right? God, we love you so much. Thank you for your word. Thank you for the chance we have to worship. And God, I pray that you'd help us to be different as a result of what we learned today. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
People need the Lord. Amen. Why don't we stand again if we could this morning? Because He lives.
I believe in the Son. I believe in the risen One. I believe I overcome by the power of His blood. Amen.
You're the only God who's worthy of anything we can give, you are God. That's just the way it is. You are God alone, from before time began. You are on your throne, you are God alone. And right now, in the good times and bad, you are on your throne, you are God alone. Unshakable, unstoppable, that's what you are. Unchangeable, unshakable, unstoppable, that's what you are. You are God alone, and before time begins, you are on your throne. You are God alone, and right now, in the good times and bad, you are on your throne, you are God alone. Unchangeable, unshakable, unstoppable, that's what you are. Unchangeable, unshakable, unstoppable, that's what you are. You are God alone, and before time began, you are on your throne, you are God alone. And right now, in the good times and bad, you are on your throne, you are God alone, you are God alone. Amen.
Well, good morning, church. Brother Herb is traveling this week, so keep him in your prayers. But we're going to have scripture reading here this morning. The scripture is in the book of Luke, chapter 22. So if you want to grab your Bibles, we are in Luke 22, and we're going to start in verse 7. Then came the day of unleavened bread, when the Passover must be killed. And he sent Peter and John, saying, "Go and prepare us the Passover, that we may eat." And they said unto him, "Where wilt thou that we prepare?" And he said unto them, "Behold, when ye are entered into the city, there shall a man meet you, bearing a pitcher of water. Follow him into the house where he entereth in. And ye shall say unto the goodman of the house, 'The master saith unto thee, Where is the guest chamber? Where shall I eat the Passover with my disciples?' And he shall show you a large upper room furnished. There make ready." And they went and found as he had said unto them, and they made ready the Passover. And when the hour was come, he sat down, and the 12 apostles with him. And he said unto them, "With desire I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say unto you, I will not any more eat thereof until it be fulfilled in the kingdom of God." And he took the cup and gave thanks and said, "Take this and divide it amongst yourselves. For I say unto you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God shall come." And he took bread and gave thanks and brake it and gave unto them, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." Likewise also the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you."
I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of glory died, my riches
Seated, turn your Bibles to Luke chapter 22. How many of you saw the communion table up on the stage today? How many of you wondered about the communion table up on the stage today? Okay, I captured your attention. That's part of what a speaker has to do, is to capture your attention, and hopefully you saw this, and hopefully it'll be a good visual for you to remember what we're talking about today. As I think about tables in somebody's life, there are a lot of important tables. Usually our tables are associated with food and with meals. Hopefully at the end of the day today, you'll go somewhere and sit at a table. How many of you guys are planning on lunch after this? Yeah, it's so fun. And we're going to do that. I don't know. Where are we going to go? We need to go somewhere. That'll be fun. Did you cook anything? Okay, good. Amen. We're going out to eat somewhere. But we all have tables. I mean, politicians talk about the kitchen table sometimes. You know, you're making decisions as a family around the kitchen table. And man, some of my best memories growing up were sitting at the kitchen table with my family, having dinner together. How many remember the Thanksgiving table? Yeah. Do you remember the kids' table? And do you remember when you graduated from the kids' table to the adult table? That was a big deal, wasn't it, right? And it's the kitchen table, for instance, is a particularly important table in the life of a family because families should share time and space together. If you're having your meal around the TV all the time, that's not a good thing, right? You need to look at each other in the face and have a meal together. That's a really important thing. When you sit at the table, it's more than just a functional place to have a meal. It's an important place to communicate and to relate to each other. It's important for families to spend time together. Some tables signify a time in life, right? Talking about when you went from the kids' table to the adult table. Some tables signify special holidays. If I talk about a Thanksgiving table, you have certain traditions, not just of the food that you eat, but like if you're like my family, there are certain traditions that go along with what you do at Thanksgiving around the table, right? Or what you do at certain times around the table when people are there. We have a kind of a ceremony at our house. A lot of times when we're having dinner together on a daily basis, we do highs and lows, you know? Tell me the best thing that happened today. Tell me the worst thing that happened today. And it's a way to connect and relate to your family. Some tables even signify relationships. How many of you guys remember going into the cafeteria when you were in high school, right? And choosing where you were going to sit and what group you were going to be associated with. That happened with me in college. Some of my best friends in the world today are people that I chose to sit with at the dinner table when I went to college. In fact, that's one of the first places I related to my wife today, is meeting her at a specific table. And I thought she was cool enough to be at our table, and she thought I was cool enough to be at her table, right? And you aim up. You always aim up, man, right? Amen? That's what you do. And so tables have some kind of significance for us. In today's text, we see reference to several different tables. That's why I'm talking about this. Meals were and are an important part of the life of Jesus. If you're studying the book of Luke with us, one of the things that was pointed out as I studied this is that this is the seventh time in the book of Luke where it's a scene with a meal. Luke liked meals. Jesus spent time with people at meals. Here we see Jesus sending the disciples to prepare a table. We see Jesus and his disciples sitting at a table. We hear Jesus talking about a table that's coming in the future. And today, what I want to do is to look at these three tables that we see in this passage, because they tell us something about our redemption. You know, Jesus came to seek and to save that which was lost. That was his mission. His mission was to redeem fallen man. And so he came to redeem us. He came to set us free from our sin. And one of the things you'll see there in Luke chapter 22, starting in verse 7, it says, "Then came the day of unleavened bread when the Passover must be killed." We see here a time. We see Jesus getting ready to purchase our redemption. And so here's the big idea today. We can remember God's work of redemption by understanding three tables referred to here in Luke chapter 22. The first table we are going to see is the Passover table. The Passover table. And what we see in the Passover table is our redemption foretold. Our redemption foretold. Verse 7 says, like I read, "Then came the day of unleavened bread when the Passover must be killed." Our text today begins with the closing events leading up to the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ here in the book of Luke. You'll see the context of what's happening starting in verse 1, where Luke makes clear to a non-Jewish audience what the Feast of Unleavened Bread is. Look at verse 1. It says, "Now the Feast of Unleavened Bread drew nigh, which is called the Passover." In this context, you'll also see what's happening in the hearts of the enemies of Jesus. The religious leaders were actively seeking and planning how they would kill Jesus. Look at verse 2. It says, "And the chief priests and scribes saw how they might kill him, for they feared the people." This is kind of in keeping with what we studied last week. Jesus claimed authority he claimed godly authority, and they didn't like it. He said, I'm authoritative. You should submit to me." They did not want to submit to him. And that's kind of a constant theme in the book of Luke, and really in all the Gospels. The chief priests and Pharisees did not see Jesus as authority. In fact, they didn't want any authority other than themselves, and so they sought to kill Jesus. And then we see in verse 3 something else that's interesting. It says, verse 3, "Then entered Satan into Judas, surnamed Iscariot, being of the number of the 12. And he went his way and communed with the chief priests and captains how he might betray him unto them. And they were glad and covenanted to give him money. And he promised and sought opportunity to betray him unto them in the absence of the multitude." So you see here kind of two things going on. Jesus has been coming from Galilee down towards Jerusalem, or as the scripture says, up towards Jerusalem, because it's up in elevation, it's down going south. And the closer he gets to Jerusalem, the closer he's getting to that march to Golgotha, that march to Calvary where he would give his life but then resurrect. It's so amazing. And you see two things happening. You see this picture of the Passover. It's the time of the Passover. Verse 1 tells us this is unleavened bread called the Passover. And you also see the chief priest and even Judas betraying, covenanting together how that they could kill Jesus. Does Jesus know this is going on? He is completely in control, as you're going to see here in a minute. Jesus absolutely knows what is going on. So when we get to verse 7, we understand the gravity and the nature of the time frame. It's Passover. Jesus and his disciples must celebrate the Passover meal. To do this, Jesus is about to send Peter and John to prepare a place for them to set a Passover table. Now, let me ask you a question. I want you to think about this. We're going to dwell on this for a minute. What was the Passover table? What was Passover all about? What happened there? Well, it's described in Exodus chapter 12. So if you have your Bibles, go back to Exodus, because it's very important that we understand what this Passover is. Exodus chapter 12. Now, I'm going to explain this as if you have never heard this story before, just so you completely understand what's going on. The children of Israel, literally the kids of Jacob, who is called Israel, had left where they were and come to Egypt because there was a famine in the land, and God had used Joseph. How many of you guys remember Joseph? God had used Joseph to preserve the Egyptians and therefore preserve his family by bringing the children of Israel over to the promised land. He, remember, Joseph looked at his brothers and said, "What you meant for evil against me in sending me to Egypt enslaved, God meant for good. God got me from Potiphar's house to a jail to the palace so that I could save much people alive. What you meant for evil, God meant for good to the saving of much people alive." But then there arose a Pharaoh that knew not Joseph. There was a guy who came in, isn't that like a politician? Someone to come in and not to not know what had been done before. And instead of being indebted to God's people, he enslaved God's people. And because the people of God the population was growing and expanding, and this Pharaoh did not like it, so he enslaved them. And God's people called out and said, "Well, how long are we going to be slaves?" And so God sent a deliverer. God sent a baby in a little bushel basket. You guys remember this? And this baby was sovereignly preserved all the way to the place where he washed up, because the mama put this baby Moses. Moses means gathered up out of to gather out of the water, drawn up. And so this Pharaoh's daughter gathered him up. Who did that, by the way? God did that, right? Did God make it so that Moses would end up being raised by the palace, raised by the princess? And so God gathered him up, raised him up in the palace, and then he began to see in that prominent place the plight of his people. He killed somebody. That's a short story. He goes to the wilderness. He sees a burning bush. God says, "Go tell Pharaoh," Moses, through that burning bush, "go tell Pharaoh to let my people go." So that's exactly what Moses did. You guys remember the story? Moses goes to Pharaoh and says, "Let my people go." And Pharaoh said, "No." He said no over and over and over again. There were 10 plagues, 9 plagues came along. All of these plagues messing up or kind of like God trash talking against a Egyptian god, by the way. They worship the Nile becomes blood. They worship their cattle, the cattle all die. They worship the sun, there's darkness. God's awesome. Right? And it came down to this last one, and the last one was the worst. The last one is the death of the firstborn son. About everyone who lived in Egypt. And so when we get to Exodus chapter 12, God comes to Aaron, the brother of Moses. He comes to Moses and he gives them instruction about this thing called the Passover. Look at verse number 1 in chapter number 12. It says, "And the Lord spake unto Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, This month shall be unto you the beginning of the months. It shall be the first month of the year to you. So God instituted a new calendar. You see that? Speak ye unto all the congregation of Israel, saying, in the 10th day of this month they shall take to them every man a what? A lamb. According to the house of their fathers, a lamb for an house. And if the household be too little for the lamb, let him and his neighbor next to his house take it according to the number of the souls. Every man according to his eating shall make your count for the lamb. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male of the first year. You shall take it out from the sheep or from the goats. And you shall keep it up until the 14th day of the same month. Meaning, you bring in this lamb, and the lamb stays from day 10 to day 14 in your house. Your meal is first dwelling with you in your house. You'll get this in a second. You shall keep it on the 14th day of the same month, and the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it in the evening. It all happened at the same time. Verse 7. And they shall take of the blood and strike it on the two posts, side posts, and on the upper door post of the houses wherein they shall eat it. So they're supposed to take this spotless, unblemished, perfect lamb. They're supposed to live with it for 4 days, and then they're supposed to kill it. And they take the blood of the goat, or the lamb, and they take hyssop, and they the branch, and then they put the blood on the doorposts, the sides and the posts of their door. The children of Israel were told later in Deuteronomy chapter 6 to put scripture verses on the posts of their doors. Later on, when God instituted the sacrificial system and the Holy of Holies and the tabernacle going on into the temple, once a year a priest would go in with the blood of a spotless lamb, and they would take the blood and they would sprinkle the blood like they did on the post. They would sprinkle it on the mercy seat, the top of the Ark of the Covenant, from this spotless lamb. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sins. You know the story. Verse 7, and they shall take the blood and strike at the two posts on the side, two side posts, and on the upper door posts of the houses wherein they shall eat. And they shall eat the flesh in that night, roast with fire and unleavened bread, and with bitter herbs they shall eat it. Eat not of it raw, nor sodden at all with water, but roast with fire. He's saying, don't eat it raw, don't boil it, roast it. And unleavened bread and with bitter herbs shall they eat it. Verse 10, and ye shall not let nothing of it remain until morning. And that which remaineth of it shall, until the morning, he shall burn with fire. And thus shall ye eat it with the loins girded and shoes on your feet and your staff in your hand. Pause there. So you're supposed to eat this meal, bitter herbs, the bread, the lamb. You're supposed to eat, to consume the lamb. And there's no leftovers. In the morning, if there's leftovers, you burn it. And this is how you're going to eat this Passover meal. This first Passover meal, you're going to eat it with your traveling clothes on. You're going to eat it with your coat, with your sandals, with your staff. In our vernacular, eat with your backpack on. Eat with your shoes on. Eat with your suitcase next to you. Why? Because I'm getting you out of Egypt. You can trust me, you can believe me, you can have faith in me. Verse 12, for I will pass through, wait, let me read verse 11, and thus shall you eat it with your loins girded, your shoes on your feet, and your staff in your hand. You shall eat it in haste. Eat it as if you're about ready to leave. It is the Lord's Passover. For I will pass through the land of Egypt this night and will smite all of the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast, and against all the gods of Egypt, I will execute judgment. That's what he's been doing the whole time, isn't it? He's doing it here. By the way, this is a spiritual battle. This is a spiritual battle. And where Jesus is, who entered the heart of Judas? This is a spiritual battle. God's been in a battle a long time. It's no contest. He's going to win. And against all the gods of Egypt, I will execute my judgment. I am the Lord, and the blood shall be to you for a token upon the houses where you are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you, and the plague shall not be upon you to destroy you when I smite the land of Egypt. Isn't that good? So the children of Israel did exactly what God said. They took a spotless lamb without blemish and sacrificed it. They broke its body and shed its blood. They put the blood on the doorposts of their homes. Then they ate this very specific meal at the table in their homes. They came to the table in their traveling clothes, believing that God would spare their firstborn sons and release them from slavery to enter into the promised land. Do you get the picture? They're enslaved in Egypt, a picture of the world. They're enslaved. They're wanting to go to a promised land, and the key to get them from going to where they were to the promised land and freed from their sin is the blood of a spotless lamb. Do you get the picture? Do I need to say it out loud? Yes, that's the rest of the message. God commanded them to eat this meal not just the night before they were to be freed, but as an annual meal that helped them to remember what God had done for them in freeing them from the bondage of Egypt. Look at verse 14. Here's what he says. And this day shall be unto you for a memorial. And ye shall keep it as a feast to the Lord throughout your generations. Ye shall keep it a feast by an what? Ordinance forever. Meaning, this is the first time you'll eat it, but you're going to keep eating this every year. Every year. There's a song I love. We will remember. We will remember. We will remember the works of your hands. We will stop and give you praise, for great is your faithfulness. God's all about remembering, right? Andrew Peterson wrote a song called Passover Us on his Christmas album, one of my favorite Christmas albums ever. And here's what the song says. Well, we all remember Moses on the banks of a river. He said, Pharaoh, you got to let my people go. You don't want me to have to tell you this 10 times over. Denial ain't just a river, you know. And we all remember Pharaoh, he just wouldn't do it, so the plagues came upon Egypt one by one. His heart was hard and the other nine just couldn't move it, so the last was the worth the death of the firstborn son. But the Lord, he gave to Moses a word for the people. He said their firstborn son would live to see another day. Put the blood of a lamb on the doorway and death would pass right over. That night all the children of Israel prayed, Lord, let your judgment pass over us. Lord, let your love hover near. Don't let your sweet mercy pass over us. Let this blood cover over us here. So the years went by, and the people, they whined and they wandered, and only sacrificed to atone for the sins of the land. So you see the priest, he placed upon the holy altar the body of a spotless lamb, and he prayed, Lord, let your judgment pass over us. Lord, let your love hover near. Don't let your sweet mercy pass over us. Let this blood cover over us here. Isn't that good? You see, Passover was not just a celebration helping the children of Israel remember what God has done. Passover was a picture of what God was going to do. John the Baptist declared this when Jesus came and when he said, Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. The Passover table was not just to be God's works remembered. the Passover table was to be our redemption foretold. We'll see that in a minute. And so Jesus knows this is happening, and in verse 8, he sends Peter and John, saying, "Go and prepare us the Passover that we may eat." And they said unto him, "Well, shall we thou we prepare?" And he said unto them, "Behold, when you're entered in the city, there shall a man meet you, bearing a pitcher of water. Follow him into the house where he entereth in. And ye shall say unto the goodman of the house, The master saith unto thee, Where is the guest chamber, where I shall eat the Passover with my disciples? And he shall show you a large upper room furnished. There make ready. And they went and found as he said unto them, and they made ready the Passover." Here we see Jesus' sovereignty in view. We see it in these very specific circumstances, him sending Peter and John to find exactly the right venue for this family meal called the Passover. He tells them exactly what to do, what person they're going to see, who to ask. He tells them what to say when he sees these people. And I love what verse 13 says, "And they went and found as he had said unto them, and they made ready the Passover." I love the obedience of the apostles, and I love the sovereignty of Jesus. Jesus was entirely in control of this whole situation and exhibited his knowledge and control in this miraculous event. But this sovereignty in this moment is just a small glimpse into his movement in all of history. Think about it. The Passover meal itself, every element of it, points to the person of Jesus Christ. We're going to see that in a minute. God ordained the events of the Exodus and the celebration of this Passover meal every year to point to the coming redemption of the Messiah. And if he can do that, then demonstrating his sovereignty and securing a room and preparing it for this familial meal together was no big deal. If there's anything I want you to take away from this week's message, it's this: God is in control. He has been active in the events of human history. Redemptive history is history. God has a plan. And God's will for you and me is to know Jesus Christ as our Savior and Lord. We can remember God's work of redemption by understanding three tables. First, the Passover table, our redemption foretold. Number two, the Lord's table. The Lord's table, our redemption remembered. Look at what he says in verse 14. "And when the hour was come." I love that expression. The book of John quotes Jesus multiple times. Jesus says over and over, my hour is not yet come. 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 And then he gets to here and it's, the hour's come. This is why he's here. This hour comes, and he said unto them, verse 15, "With desire I have desired to eat this Passover with you," what does he say? "Before I suffer." Jesus has been waiting. Jesus has been excited. He's coming to this second table we're going to look at. He's coming to this table, and he says, "It is the passion of my heart to have this meal with you." And then he institutes something very new. Verse 19, "And he took the bread and gave thanks and broke it and gave it unto them, saying, This is my body which is given for you." Read the next few words with me. "This do in remembrance of me." Likewise, also the cup after saying, "This is the cup, is the New Testament of my blood which is shed for you." The disciples had prepared this Passover meal. The table was set, and the appointed time came. They were certainly about to partake in this Passover meal, which was typically enjoyed together with family members. This certainly would have been a time that felt different than any other Passover meals that the disciples had ever experienced. Jesus takes the bread, and he says something interesting. He says, "This bread is my body." He breaks it and he hands it out to them. And the disciples would have thought, man, I've had this meal over and over again, and what you're saying is this Passover meal is really a meal about you? this Passover meal that we've been doing, we thought it was about Moses. We thought it was about Egypt. But what you're saying is this Passover meal is about you, this bread that's unleavened, without leaven, without sin. This unleavened, perfect bread is broken. And you're saying when it's broken, it's about you. And he takes this drink and he says, likewise, also the cup. So he says, this cup is a new testament in my blood, which is shed for you. The blood is that picture of that lamb, remember, posted on the doors. He's saying, this cup that you've had all these years is a picture of my blood that's going to be shed for you. And then he gives them this ordinance in verse 19. There was an ordinance of the Passover. Hey, do this to remember me. Do this to remember what I did for you, Israel. Jesus gives a new ordinance. He says, do this in remembrance not of the Passover. Do this in remembrance of me, because this meal is about me. That blew your mind? Jesus was about to suffer and die for them, and not just for them, but for the sin of the whole world. The Apostle Paul spoke of this when he said that he received from the Lord the importance of keeping this ordinance in the local church. In 1 Corinthians 11, 23, it says this, for I have received of the Lord that which I also delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you, this do in remembrance of me. After that same manner, he took the cup, and when he had supped, saying, this cup is the new testament in my blood. This do you as often as you drink it. What is it? In remembrance of me. And then he says something really interesting. For as often as you eat of this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death till he come. Till he comes. Till he comes. He's coming back. This is going to be awesome. He's coming back. When we partake of the Lord's table, we do to remember the redemption that was secured for us. We remember the body that was broken and the blood that was shed so we can know our sins were forgiven. Peter said this in 1 Peter, for as much as you know that you're not redeemed by corruptible things, as silver and gold from your vain conversation received by the tradition of your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot, who verily was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you, whom by him do believe in God, and that raised him up from the dead and gave him glory, that your faith and your hope might be in God. We have to remember and trust in the precious blood of the Lord Jesus Christ that purchased our redemption. We can remember God's work of redemption by understanding three tables. The Passover table is our redemption foretold. The Lord's table is our redemption purchased and remembered. The kingdom table is our redemption realized. Our redemption's going to be realized. In verse 16, Jesus said this to the disciples. He's drinking of the cup. Verse 16, for I say unto you, I will not any more eat thereof until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. And he took the cup and gave thanks and said, take this and divide it among yourselves, for I say unto you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God shall come. And they do this meal. You read, when you read these other passages of scripture that talk about the meal, you understand that as he starts talking about kingdom, the disciples start arguing about who is going to be best in the kingdom. How many of you guys remember that? Who's going to be greatest in the kingdom? Then, of course, it's in this moment that God, as they're arguing, Jesus gets up and girds himself, pours a bowl, begins to wash their feet, and then he says, you don't know what I've done for you. The greatest among you is going to be your servant. So they're arguing about the kingdom. They're talking about this kingdom coming. Look down at verse 28. He says this about them. Ye are they which have continued with me in my temptations, and I appoint unto you a kingdom as my Father hath appointed unto me. He's saying, hey, the kingdom's coming. Remember when he started preaching, what did John preach? Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Make straight the path of the Lord. And Jesus, his message was, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. The disciples were thinking, hey, when is the kingdom coming? Jesus prayed, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. The kingdom's already, but the kingdom is not yet. He says here, look at verse 29, and I appointed unto you a kingdom as my Father appointed unto me, that ye may eat and drink, what is it? At my table. In my kingdom. There's a table back there that pointed to a table here. This do in remembrance of me, but there's a table coming. It's a real table. It is a real kingdom. And if you know Jesus as your Savior, we're really going to be there having a meal with Jesus. No, you don't understand. We're going there. It's going to be exciting. We're going to go be with Jesus. He is a benevolent dictator. His will is going to be accomplished. And you want to be on his side. Because he's been working all of history to not just purchase our redemption so that we're saved and we have the Holy Spirit. But what is that Holy Spirit? It's a down payment on an inheritance to come, a real kingdom where we get to go and be with God. I'm not crazy. It's going to happen. Jesus is coming back, and he's purchased our redemption by the blood of the spotless Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. This is not some disembodied, ambiguous spiritual state. This is not a metaphor for something we don't understand. We will physically be with Jesus in an everlasting kingdom and glorified, resurrected bodies. There will be a new heaven and a new earth, and we're going to go be with him. And there's a future meal. Some people, is this the marriage supper of the Lamb? What is this? It's a meal with Jesus at some point in the future. Hopefully we're going to have a lot of them. Who wants to go? I want to go. I like Cheddar's. I like El Rancho, whatever, Fiesta. I'm pretty sure in the new kingdom there's no calories. Amen? It's going to be amazing. And it's not going to be amazing just because of the food or just because of the environment. It's going to be amazing because we're going to be with Jesus. All of history is moving toward a day where every wrong will be made right. Every loose end will be tied up. There will be ultimate justice. Our God will be with us, and we will be with him, and there will be another time for communion. John said it this way in Revelation 21, and I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. And there shall be no more death, neither sorrow, nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. And he that sat upon the throne said, behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, write, for these words are true and faithful. And he said unto me, it is done. I am the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is athirst of the fountain of the water of life freely. He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son. But here's the scary part. But the fearful and the unbelieving and the abominable and murderers and whoremongers and sorcerers and idolaters and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. Everybody is going to live forever somewhere. The Lord foretold of our redemption at a Passover table. Jesus bought our redemption with his blood. And when we take communion, when we take that bread and that body, we remember his death until he comes. So that those who would believe on him would not just be saved from their sin, they would be saved unto eternal life, to spend eternity with God forever. But when you die, you're going to spend eternity somewhere. Hell isn't a place reserved for really bad people, and no good people will be there. There's no such thing as a good person. The Bible says there's none good, no, not one. You don't have to spend eternity in the lake of fire. You can spend eternity with Jesus. All of human history has been marching towards this time. Where are you going to spend eternity? Passover table is our redemption foretold. The Lord's table is our redemption remembered. The kingdom table will be our redemption realized. Are you going to heaven? Jesus shed his blood for you. His blood was poured out for you. If you don't put your faith in him, you're going to spend eternity separated from God. I want you with us. I want you at the meal. I want you with Jesus. Today is the day of salvation. Today. Would you bow your heads and close your eyes with me? How many of you would say, Pastor Ben, I'm saved, I know I'm saved, and I'm a member of Trinity Baptist, and we give testimony to that today. Is that you? Would you raise your hand? That's all. Hey, becoming a member of our church doesn't get you to heaven, but if you're saved and you know you're saved, man, we're so glad that you're here and that you're a member of our church. That's fantastic. How many of you guys would say, Pastor Ben, I'm saved too, but I'm not a member of your church, but I have that same precious faith. Would you raise your hand? Yeah, all over the room, man. If God's leading you, we would love to have you be a part of this ministry so you can be on our mission with us. How many would say, Pastor Ben, if Jesus were to come back right now, I don't know that I'd go to be with him. I don't know for sure that heaven is my home. I don't know for sure if my sins are forgiven. Jesus' blood is sufficient to pay for your sins, but it's only efficient to those who call on the name of the Lord. The Bible says that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. If you're here today and you don't know Jesus as your Savior, today is the day of salvation. We want to take God's word and show you how you can know for sure heaven's your home. How many of you would say, Pastor Ben, I've kind of been living life without heaven in view. I've been living life thinking all about what's going on right here and not thinking about God's kingdom come. I'm not living how I ought to live. And that's how I need to apply this message today. I got to live understanding what God's done for me and looking forward to the day he's coming back. If Jesus were to come back today, are you ready to see him? Are you ready to see him? At Trinity Baptist, we do something kind of old school. I think it's right for us to respond to the word of God when it goes out. And so we're going to have a chance for an invitation. And if you want to respond to what God's doing to you, either doing in you and through you and through his word today, either at your seat or coming forward, we would want to invite you to do that. Would you stand with me? Every head bowed, every eye closed. No one looking around. Everybody stand with me. We're going to pray, and if God impresses on you to come and respond, we want to let you do that. God, thank you for your word. Thank you for your spirit. Thank you for the redemption that's in the blood of the spotless Lamb, Jesus Christ. I pray that you'd help us to respond to that today. We love you in Jesus' name. Whatever God's doing in your heart, now's a chance to respond on this verse.
The Savior is waiting to enter your heart. Why don't you let him come in? There's nothing
can look up here. Are you ready for Jesus to come back? I can't wait. It's going to be amazing. We're so excited this morning that Eli Sewell has come forward because he wants to get baptized. He has gotten saved. Yeah, yes, give him a hand. That's awesome. I love seeing parents raise their children in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. Amen. And kids getting saved. It's amazing. The last 2 weeks we've baptized some kids, and so that's really cool. So we'll do that again next Sunday. We're excited about that. Come back tonight. We're continuing in our series on Wise Living in Foolish Times at 5 o'clock. If you haven't already done so, there's giving boxes at the back, and so be faithful in your giving to the Lord. We're so grateful for that. I'm going to ask Brother Dave to come, and he's going to end our service in a word of prayer. And after he prays and dismisses us, you are not dismissed, you're sent. All right? Thank you.
Father, we do thank you for the word of God. We thank you, Lord, that we can come and sit and eat and feast on your word, Lord, and that it'll nourish us and that it'll build us up and it will give us the strength. But, Lord, we pray that you, your Holy Spirit, convict our hearts to always have the will to submit to your word. We ask that now in Jesus' precious name. Amen.